So just to get started, a couple of real brief slides. I haven't seen some of these statistics this week, and I think it's important to note that the banks who are considered globally systemically important, and of course Wells Fargo is one of those, that most of the top 10 are in the U.S., but in the European Union, there are another group of banks that are considered globally systemically important, including Nordea. We'll talk about them in a few minutes. But from the Basel III risk data reporting requirements and recent reports that have come out of the regulators, it's pretty clear that the number of banks that are not meeting the Basel III requirements is a fairly high number. And one of the reasons for that is that there are certain things that they just are not doing well. Throughout the assessments that have been done so far, and especially in the European Union, they're falling down with respect to data architecture and IT capability, with respect to the accuracy and integrity of their data governance, timeliness, adaptability, all of those things, they're all missing. And so Nordea and a number of the large banks in the EU have been fined heavily for that, and they are not happy about being fined. And so what they really are starting to get and to organize around is that they need to do something about this. And as it turns out, the lowest area of compliance across the board, according to the ECB, the European Central Bank, is in data architecture and IT infrastructure. And this is certainly a big pain point for Nordea. And close second is governance. And so what we have been doing is working with Nordea to build up capability within the bank to address some of those issues. A lot of them involve changes in personnel, but others involve education and training, and they involve a re-architecture of IT systems, and a whole number of things that they have to do in order to do a better job of meeting their requirements. So Nordea Bank is the largest financial services group in the Nordics, which includes Norway, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, and Nordea actually is also in business in Russia, in the Netherlands, and they have offices in New York. They have roughly 11 million customers. They have roughly 650 billion euros under management. They are a very, very large institution, even though many of us in the U.S. have never heard of them. So, just saying, they're the largest bank in the Nordics, and they typically are compared with Deutsche Bank and a few others in the European Union. I don't think they're quite as big as Deutsche, they may not be as big as Credit Suisse, but they're still in the top 10. So the work area that we're talking about here involves capital markets, and part of what we've been doing with them is to look at their business architecture, look at their value chains, understand where data governance needs to play. Some of the main areas involved in that work include product valuation, position management, P&L reporting, all very basic things you would think, except that there are 35 systems for trading. There are 17 systems that give them sources for market data. There are another 50 systems that report in with respect to the P&L process. So the challenge is they have all of these siloed systems, many of which do not speak to one another, and then within the bank they speak 5 different languages, none of which is the bank language officially, which is English. But if you walk down the hall, what you hear is a bit of Danish, a bit of Swedish, a bit of Norwegian, Russian over here, French over there, because they've hired people from all these other banks, a lot of German. And the challenge for them in a multilingual setting with respect to a common language that they can use for governance purposes and just to speak, to communicate with one another across the bank is huge. So we looked at the data management maturity model and which aspects of it were really business-facing that they cared about in order to meet the regulatory requirements. And so for us, as a starting point, we're talking really about their data management strategy and specifically about governance, which is where FIBO comes into play. And so working with the business side, getting them to understand that they own the governance process, it's not owned by IT, it's something the business has to champion. They have to own the data sources that reflect their capabilities and the value streams that they're involved in. Even getting past that point has taken some work. But I think we're getting closer. And so the objectives for the program that we're working with and to establish include just putting the principles in place for supporting the business data owners, creating their policies and a knowledge base for data governance and metadata management, ensuring that the metadata meets the requirements of BCDS 239, among other regulatory requirements that they're faced with, and then getting IT to collaborate with them so that the metadata is complete, accurate, and that their data schema can be aligned with it. So there's a number of things involved in that process, and FIDO plays a critical role in the middle. Nordam came to the U.S. in, 2 years ago. In the first part of the year, they went to Wells Fargo, they went to J.P. Morgan Chase, they went to see people at Citibank, several banks in New York, in order to figure out what they could do and what American banks were doing to address some of these challenges. And it was through that they got involved with FIBO and were introduced to us. So we start from the business architecture because they are still having challenges understanding what they do. And so really working with a strong business architecture to identify who their stakeholders are, who the managers of the data owners are, what the relevant processes are for a particular area, and so forth has been critical, and we're extracting business vocabulary from the resulting business architecture. That process is the one that's followed by the folks in the Business Architecture Guild. If any of you are familiar with that, it's affiliated with OMG. Unfortunately, my partner was not able to be here to tell you more than that. He's the founder of the Business Architecture Guild and is a luminary in the field, a retired IBM distinguished engineer and a fabulous business architect. And Jim, unfortunately, had a family member pass away late last week, so he's not with us today. But what we do is put together a series of value chains. So what you see here is the P&L, producing the P&L value stream, which has a number of capabilities associated with it. So the value chain, the members of the value stream are across the top. You have the various capabilities in the sort of pink boxes down below that, things like valuation control and reviewing the valuations for all kinds of instruments that are on the books, et cetera, in order to come up with final P&L for the day. Out of that work, once we've had the value streams and capabilities identified, we build an information map that talks about what pieces of information are required both to deliver that capability and that come out of that capability. And again, more terminology can be derived from the information that's in that map and also from the interviews that are done to develop it. So the overall strategy with respect to metadata, once we have at least an idea of the capabilities for a particular area that we're working with, are to reuse standards and best practices where possible. Because Nordea had so much trouble with a common language, given the number of languages they speak, given how they overload English terms incorrectly, and all of the other things that were going on in the bank, they felt that starting with standards was really critical. It was the only way they were going to succeed. And so we've been using FIBO as the basis for that. And in fact, some of the knowledge that's come out of the work with Nordea has already been integrated into some of the emerging FIBO standards, including business and commerce. In addition to that, we derive information and metadata from the business architecture, as I mentioned. And we've been working with Nordea to tailor the policies and principles derived from the data management maturity model in order to put their own program in place. And then finally, education of the IT people involved so that they can actually adapt their systems and data architecture to comply. So the governance program that's in place now at Nordea includes a tremendous amount of stakeholder analysis because, again, they're new to the game and they're really trying to get their hands dirty. and understand what it is that they need to do. So they all participate in active sessions for developing the value streams, identifying the capabilities that are involved in the business architecture. From those, we've been working with them to look at the business process models that they already have in place, identify where those need to be modified, and to map those onto the capability and information map and onto the other vocabulary so that everything starts to line up and they're using the same terms across all of those artifacts. We've created with them a glossary that extends the set of standards that we're using from FIBO and elsewhere for any of the elements or metadata identified by the business architecture and through their use cases. And so that's all collected in right now an Access database. We'll be moving that to Startup hopefully this coming fall. And we'll talk about that in a few minutes. And so once we have at least a glossary for the terms that we can't find in FIBO, then we look at the relationships between those. We try to establish connections with FIBO and put more of a at least taxonomic and high-level logical ontology together. We work with their team to document the business rules that are associated with those elements that are in the business glossary that comes out of that work, and then work with IT to connect that to their IT artifacts, including their business logical demo. So from a terminological perspective, this is one of the sort of big time requirements of the BCDS 239 standard. They're asking for integrated taxonomies and architecture across the banking group. It's a huge challenge for a bank that has a retail bank, a wholesale bank, a wealth management group, an insurance company, et cetera, et cetera. And they are small in comparison to many of the large American banks. But the vocabulary is what provides the basis for ground truth in order to meet those requirements. And it's comprised not only of metadata, but of a unified, logically consistent approach to concept identification, naming, representation, and modeling so that they can do end-to-end data governance using that vocabulary. We've been building our vocabulary terminology with them using an ISO 704 approach. How many of you have ever seen or heard of ISO 704? So it's the terminology work standard in ISO, which maybe some of you might want to go out and read if this is important to you. And so what that involves is a rigorous process of building up definitions, ensuring that they have a standard format, making sure that you have annotations that support them, including what sources were used to define things, examples, usage notes, and a myriad of other annotations that we use in order to define something so that people at the bank can understand what you mean by a particular concept. And so there's a process identified here, I won't go through it since we're publishing the slides for you to grab, that we use in order to come up with a real good glossary with annotations that is input to the ontology development piece. So once we have that, then we do the analysis of the relationships they know of, either from the information map, from their current schema, from what we know from FIBO, to put together additional pieces that are part of the ontology. So we started with them on a pilot program involving the definition of trade. That took us 3 months and resulted in 200 terms in addition to the word trade in order to actually meet the goal. Some percentage of the concepts were already in FIBO, not all of them. But we've contributed many of those back. Subsequent pilots included market valuation, and now collateral optimization is where we're working at the moment. So these are very huge areas as well. 500 concepts related to market valuation, we still are counting with respect to collateral optimization. And many of those are not yet in FIBO, but Nordea is committed to contributing back what they can. So we had some tooling challenges, and I'm going to run through this quickly because we're running out of time, but there were no tools to support the vocabulary piece that we could find. That you could use a taxonomy tool, but most of them didn't support the level of annotations that we needed. There, people were comfortable with Excel. We ended up building a prototype in Access that we're now planning to move to Stardock. There were a few tools also for support of collaborative review of the terminology, not in desktop tools, but over the internet for the SMEs to look at. And that, we've built a prototype tool in Stardock, which everyone's going to talk about in a moment. And then we're looking at additional tooling, and we've tested some Sparkle queries early on for looking at their logical schema and validating those via the ontology, making sure that the definitions line up. So we're using Sparkle queries against Stardock to do that, and comparing that against their logical data models, which are in an IBM framework, which was mentioned earlier today, IGC. I forget what the acronym stands for. So this is a view of the prototype tool for terminology entry, which is pretty straightforward. You can see these in the slide deck. This is an extension to FIBO for market valuation calculations, where this is a protege view of the ontology, and what we've done here is only the things in black were needed to be added to FIBO. Everything else comes directly from FIBO that we are using to define market value calculations. And then specific calculations will have additional parameters. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Everett.
Thank you. Yeah, so as much as Protege is a great tool for editing ontologies and viewing for experienced users, it's not really something you can put in front of the subject matter experts at the bank. So we built this tool, mostly Jim, to display, visualize the ontology contents in a way that's a little more human readable. And aesthetics was not the top priority functionality was. So what you see here is visuals, the details about a certain concept, annotations about that concept, what kind of formula it for represents this concept, part of the class hierarchy related to that concept, and also a natural language representation of the axioms in the ontology. So rather than showing the web ontology language as is, it's a little more readable natural language representation of that definitions. So behind the scenes, what's happening, it's a JavaScript-based application that's sending queries to the Stardock database. The ontologies that have been developed in Protege are loaded into the database, and the front end is sending these queries live. So as you click the links, all the links you see here are clickable, so you can navigate through the ontology definitions while the queries are the content is being pulled from the database as you browse through the definitions. So I'd like to talk just a little bit about the internals of the Stardock database and link it to our use cases. So Stardock has the standard capabilities that you would find in any kind of RDF database. So the core is an RDF database with a Sparkle query engine, so you can load your FIBO ontologies or any ontology that's represented in RDF and ONL into Stardock directly, SCOS and PRO being the most common ontologies used in the financial domain in addition to FIBO. And there's a reasoning component, so you can run your queries and have all the ontology reasoning happen as the query is being answered. It also supports rules as well, so you can add rules on top of your ontologies to infer relationships and get them as your query results. But the ultimate goal with the Stardock that we are developing at Complexo is to make it a data unification platform. So not just handle structured data represented in RDF, but we also index natural text that is in the part of the data. So if you have some blobs, some descriptions, we index them with Lucene, and then you can use free text queries to get back those results. Or if you have geospatial data encoded somewhere, coordinates or locations, we can index them as well, then you can run queries like find me these instances that are this much close to a location. You can link to legacy data that's in relational databases and use R2RML mappings to represent that data as RDF. So you can have this RDF view over data that's being stored in a SQL database, run your Sparkle queries and they are automatically translated to SQL and answered. And there's also, so this feature that is going to be available in the upcoming release, which is extracting text from documents like PDF or Word. That's, you can feed these kind of documents into Stardock where metadata will be extracted and stored as RDF. The text inside the documents will be indexed as well, and you can also configure storage for storing these documents. So whenever you run a query and find, for example, okay, I find this policy about expressing the domain, where is this coming from? You can go and trace it back to the original PDF document where those policies were described, for example. So next steps in this work will be continuing the development of the vocabulary, and a preliminary deployment is planned for later in this year in the Nordia intranet. And the focus will be the developing the vocabulary on the trade-oriented concepts and collateral optimizations. And on the interface side, we'll be working more on the research and review process. So as you see, we just have a proof of concept, but we want to build a better tool for subject matter experts to see the definitions, verify them, and validate those definitions in a better way. And we are going to be using the text extraction indexing capabilities that I just mentioned, so that we can link the vocabulary terms to the original documents and have the tracing back to the original policy documents. We'll be prototyping a schema validation tool for the data warehouse project. So that's what Elisa mentioned before. So when you when the data the schemas for the data warehouse are being generated, we'll be using the Sparkle queries to validate those schemas, and we might be also using the RDF R2RML mappings as well to pull in data as well. And we are planning to use the text indexing capability on the interface side as well, so that the business architecture related terminology that users are seeing on the front end can take leverage of that as well. So,
yes, so just a few final thoughts. The sales process in the organization is still long, and it's difficult. And getting people on board when there are a lot of reorganizations in an organization is also challenging. So, you know, being able to show early wins is what's led to the success that we've had so far. And the other key has been centralization of the governance process and of the metadata, so that all of the different organizations within the bank are using that same approach and terminology. So that's all we have. Thank you very much. The slides should be available online.
As I said this morning, vendors are really, really important for us, as are the use cases that the my boat in real life. And so I asked Elisa to bring the bank, to bring the vendor to do exactly what I wanted to do. Tomorrow we have a whole session, two of them, dedicated to the vendors. Peter Ben's going to start off by showing a evaluation form that we've been doing and asking vendors to fill that out. And then tomorrow evening, after the last keynote in this room, any vendor who wants to come, I've invited all the ones who express an interest. You're welcome to come here. We're going to talk about more cooperation in 2016 and beyond. So without any questions for Alicia, then. Yes, sir.
Are you attempting to build a multilingual glossary terminology for this, for Nordea?
So the question is, are we attempting to build a multilingual glossary for Nordea? And the answer is eventually. We are not starting there. Having common definitions in English is the first goal. And then once we have those and people start overloading the English terms, bless you, then we are intending to represent the ontology in Swedish and Danish at a minimum. Not sure whether they want to do Russian and Finnish yet. I need native speakers to help me with that. But yes, eventually. Yes.
How did you integrate the existing relational data? Did you do that by duplicating it to a triple store, or is that virtual?
There's no intent to do that. So the plan is, from the perspective of the metadata that they have a number of tools they're using. So we're taking the ontology using Sparkle queries, driving the metadata back into, I think, the IBM business glossary tool, whatever that is, and into some of their other stores. And with respect to the logical schema, they're still early on in defining their new warehouse. So we're at the front end, so we can tell them what terminology to use and then use the Sparkle queries against Stardog to validate that that's what they did. So we're still early on enough that it's not so much a big deal for changing their existing database.